Westerners accept that Darwin first expounded the doctrine of evolution, the science of anthropology is not new. The development of evolutionary process was known long before from the Bhagavatam, which was written 5,000 years ago. There are records of the statements of Kapila Muni, who was present almost in the beginning of the creation. This knowledge has existed since Vedic time, and all these sequences are disclosed in Vedic literature. The theory of gradual evolution or anthropology is not new to the Vedas. It is said here that among the trees there are also evolutionary processes. The different kinds of trees have touch perception. It is said that better than trees are the fish, because fish has developed the sense of taste. Better than fish are the bees, who have developed the sense of smell. And better than them are the serpents, because serpents have developed the sense of hearing. In the darkness of night, a snake can find its eatable simply by hearing the frog's very pleasant cry. The snake can understand there is the frog, and it captures the frog simply because of its sound vibration. This example is sometimes given for persons who vibrate sound simply for death. One may have a very nice tongue that can vibrate sound like the frog's, but that kind of vibration is simply calling death. The best use of the tongue and of the sound vibration is to chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. That will protect one from the hands of cruel death. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purport. So this evolution of the material bodies is also a fact which is revealed in the Vedas. As Prabhupada says, when 5,000 years back, this fact about the evolution of the material bodies has been recorded in Bhagavata Purana and many other literature, Vedic literature. The only difference between the Darwinian theory of evolution and the evolution that is being spoken in the Vedas is, one is the Darwinian evolution is just observing the connection between different kinds of bodies, human body, ape body, or birds, all these bodies they are seeing. Based on that, they are seeing that there is a connection of the different forms evolving into a greater prospect of survival. In other words, Darwinian theory is a theory of how the living entities in the material world, the different forms are progressively moving towards more successfully lording over. And that is very much explained in our philosophy, that all the living entity in this material world are constantly struggling or working for lording over the material nature. Some lord over better, some lord over less. Some are successful, some are not successful or partially successful. So this lording is connected to survival. So Darwinian theory of evolution is based on the principle of survival. And that very much goes in line with the philosophy of Krishna consciousness. That is as far as the bodies are concerned. But what they miss out is they do not know who is the occupant of this body. The occupant of this body is another energy, which is a spirit soul, which is a spirit, Brahman. The occupant of the body, in the body, in different bodies, their consciousness is evolving according to the nature of the consciousness, contaminated consciousness that each body produces. Each body is ultimately in association with the soul, and the soul and the super soul produces a particular type of contaminated consciousness, chitta, with which the soul associates. So as far as the soul is concerned, the spirit is always eternal, but its consciousness that surrounds the soul, it evolves according to law of karma, according to how the soul acts. He gets different types of bodies with different facilities of experiencing greater degree of lording over. Just like if you have good karma, then you see that you have more freedom to move material energy the way you want. If you have bad karma, then you don't have that much freedom to do so many things. If your bad karma is so much that morning to evening you are only made to earn money to eat and sleep, no time for anything else. That is bad karma. Almost all human beings who are going and working in the ITs or, you know, in a transcendental language, we can call them as IT coolies. The coolies also, they go morning to evening, they work hard, and for what? Just to eat and sleep. So IT coolies are a little sophisticated eating, sophisticated sleeping, and sophisticated sense gratification. So basically the material bodies are given to living entities according to one's free will that he exercises. History of his free will, the accumulated history of the reaction of his free will is what gives him the possibilities in life. So that is the process of evolution. The Vedic scriptures are talking about. But one thing, because the Darwinian theory is just sticking to the evolution of the bodies, they think it is going in one direction of more and more survival capability. But according to the theory of evolution of the souls, the soul can either evolve or it can devolve. It can evolve into a higher species or it can fall back into lower species. Just say, it's not that some soul has, you know, evolved from animal to finally it has evolved to human form. These forms are independently existing. If our consciousness is evolving through different forms of life, but it is a living entity, this living entity according to his act, according to his karma, he evolves into higher species, he becomes a demigod, or he becomes an animal. Once we fall into an animal species, then with whatever bad karma that suits, the reactions of the bad karma, that kind of an animal body will get, and then we have to go through those animal bodies, experience those. Just like Prabhupada says, if you want to eat flesh, 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 you can get a tiger's body. So the living entity evolves both directions, either positively, progressively, or he can evolve from Brahma to Abrahma Bhuvana Loka Punaravartana Arjuna. Up and down the living entities can experience consciousness, expanded consciousness and constricted consciousness. Certain forms of life have constricted consciousness. Certain forms of life have unrestricted consciousness. Human form of life is unlimited, as bigger. Does not necessarily mean physical freedom or freedom of money, etc. Even our subtle body experiences freedom. The freedom to have time to think, atato brahma jijnasa, that is a big freedom. People who have so much of, they don't have to struggle for material existence, have money, etc., but they don't have the good fortune of sitting and asking this question, atato brahma jijnasa. So it is a fact, as Prabhupada is explaining here, it starts with the consciousness, the levels of consciousness starts with hardly any sense perception. Then you have sense perception of touch. Trees, Prabhupada said, trees have touch perception. Better than the trees are fish, because fish has developed sense of taste. Better than fish are the bees, who have developed the sense of smell. Better than them are the serpents, because serpents have developed the sense of hearing. So that is one level of evolution of the body. Of course, the hearing of the human form is different from the hearing of the snake. Hearing of the snake, now we're talking about sense perception. Per se, that the ability of a snake to hear is more than an other animal species. That is why it is always say, they always say, experienced people say, you never have to be afraid of snakes unless you stamp them. Because they hear your footsteps and they will run away. They know some human being is around. They will never come nearby. But by chance, if you step on it, then it will bite you. Otherwise, snakes are never to be feared. They on their own, they don't come and bite at all. Because it bites according to its defense mechanism. If somebody is, when it feels threatened, then it will bite. So, if you're walking in the forest, all this, you go with heavy steps, then you don't have to fear that snakes will come. They would all just, even if they are in the path, they will run away because they are so sensitive to human steps or anybody stepping. So this hearing is different from the hearing of the human form. That's another type. If you see in the human form, sense of touch, smell, taste, all of them are developed. They are not only developed within the human species. Different human beings have developed the fineness of taste, smell, touch, etc., etc. So there is a quality of taste. There is a quality of hearing. So in other words, consciousness also, human consciousness also has again different levels of, just like out of 84 lakh species, 4 lakh species are human species. Among the, in this human species, 4 lakh types of consciousness are there. And the sensitivity to sense of taste, smell, touch, etc. is different according to the sensitivity of the mind of the living entity, of the human living entity in the human form. The living entity in the human form has not only have evolved sense perception, but they also have an evolved mind. According to the level of evolution of the mind, level of evolution of the mind means tamoguna to rajoguna to sattuguna. So if someone has, a human being has got a hearing in sattuguna, that quality is different from hearing in tamoguna. Hearing in sattuguna means hearing with meaning. Hearing in tamoguna means only you hear. If I say pen, the idea of a pen comes. If I am in tamoguna, in other words, I do not know what a pen is, I only hear the word pen. If I have knowledge that what is a pen, when I say pen, the idea of pen also comes, isn't it? So in the same way, material sounds, we are talking about material sounds. Material sounds, if you hear, then you need to have quality of hearing, then only you will understand the meaning of that word. Shabda means not only gross sound, but also the meaning associated with that sound. This is the material sound. But when it comes to the sound, transcendental sound, sound cannot be separated from the meaning of the sound. Because in this material world, everything is heterogeneous. In the sense, sound, there is a gross sound. The meaning of the sound is in the mind. You have to put A and B together, and then you say pen, you will see the pen. Because this connection is made in the mind, in the material world. But in the spiritual world, you say one word, in the connection between the word and the meaning of the word is not in the mind. The connection, if you say water, 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 water in the spiritual world, the idea of water is also there in that water, because every sound is Chinmaya Shabda. Chit is included in it. So spiritual sound is very important. As I said, if you go on saying pen, 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 if you have, nobody has taught you what a pen is, eternally you can chant pen, 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 the idea of pen will not manifest. Why? Because in the sound pen, the idea of pen does not exist. They are two different things. Mind has to put them together. If you chant Krishna, 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 go on chanting. Only sound. In fact, say, don't worry about the meaning, only sound. Because in the sound, the meaning of the sound, the person whose name the sound is, everything is inseparably one Advaya Jnana, non-different from each other, is existing in that sound. This is the secret of only hearing Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. That is why Prabhupada says, simply hear Hare Krishna. So simply hearing Hare Krishna is not tamoguna. You should not think that, oh, simply hearing Hare Krishna is tamoguna. If I chant Hare Krishna and think of Krishna, then that is better chanting, sattuguna chanting. No, if you chant Hare Krishna and think of Krishna now, you are putting something from your mind onto the transcendental sound. Rather, simply hear and wait for the transcendental sound to reveal the self-contained meaning within that sound. One should have this faith. The scriptures are revealing that the Shabda contains everything. Krishna Nama contains everything. So material sounds are just sounds. They do not contain. Sound is one thing, form is all are isolated. A human mind is required to put them together. Intrinsically in that sound, there is nothing but a phenomena. But intrinsically in the sound Nama, Hare Krishna, in that sound, the transcendental name, form, activities, everything is included in it. Then why we need to vibrate that sound? When we are creating that sound, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, how is it that the sound that I create becomes Krishna? Does Krishna not have an independent existence? When I create, that means I am creating Krishna. This sound that we vibrate, no doubt it is a vibration that we produce. That is called Nama Bhasa. We produce with our tongue, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. It is just like the brass body of the deity or, you know, stone of the deity. But the Lord descends into that vibration. Which Lord? The Nama, which is non-different from Krishna, the spiritual sound, descends into the sound that you and me vibrate. And therefore, this is no longer an ordinary vibration. This vibration also contains Krishna. That means through this vibration, simply by hearing this vibration of Hare Krishna Mahamantra, simply by hearing your 16 rounds, there is a direct infusion of spiritual knowledge, spiritual energy, chitta energy into your consciousness. The reason we don't experience this is because when we chant Hare Krishna, we don't keep our mind free from thinking. If you simply hear, then this realization, you permit or you allow the holy name to reveal, to make the transcendental chitta energy flow into you. Just like if the rain is falling on the rock cannot absorb because of the nature of the rock. On a soft earth, good earth, it's like a sponge, it absorbs the water. The same way, the Nama Avatara of the Lord is there on our tongue. Our mind can be like a rock, or mind can be like a good earth, like a sponge. Being like a rock during japa means you are constantly thinking of thought processing. Instead of simply directing and hearing, chanting, hearing, chanting, hearing, chanting, hearing. If you simply chant here, chant here, chant here, it's very difficult because the mind, we think that everything, my mind should be there. Without my mind, nothing. Now I chant means my mind should be there. Mind is our master. We simply have to ignore our mind and then only chant and hear, direct. Engage the mind in directing the tongue, directing the hearing, bead after bead, bead after bead, bead after bead. Then we are not like a rock. The holy name who is on our tongue will cause flow of chitta energy into our consciousness. I am not this body becomes very obvious. I am existence, I am Sat becomes very clear. What is Asat becomes very clear in our perception. And what is our Sat purpose of life becomes obvious. What is Asat and the how asat, this material body, has to serve the sat. Asat means temporarily existing. How it has to serve the eternal existence of myself. All this mercy of the holy name flows into us if we simply chant and hear Hare Krishna Mahamantra. Prabhupada, in this last part of the purport, he is saying that people who simply speak nonsense, not in glorification of Krishna, their speaking or their shabda is like a frog croaking to attract the snake of death. Big talk, full of pride of their intelligence, of their understanding, and death comes just like the croaking of a frog attracts the death snake. In the same way, death is attracted by these people. Big atheists, people who talk against Krishna, let them stop their death. Death comes to them, and that time they have no explanation, they have no answer, their intellect cannot comprehend what is this death. So therefore Prabhupada says, the best use of the tongue, of the sound vibration and of the sound vibration, is to chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. That will protect one from the hands of cruel death. So therefore keep the mind's thought processing away from chanting the Hare Krishna during japa. Simply chant and hear, chant and hear, chant and hear, chant and hear, chant and hear. Simultaneously. Vibrate, and you know that vibration. Know the result of the vibration. Result of vibration is what? Sound. So you have to know. Doing and knowing, doing and knowing, doing and knowing. No thinking. Then Prabhupada says, transcendental thinking will be pushed upon our consciousness. The name, form, activities of the Lord will be revealed by the holy name. It will play, it will flow out of the holy name. The quality of that thinking of Krishna, that kind of thoughts of Krishna, they are all sweet. They are, you can differentiate easily if it is material thoughts or your own shadow thoughts of Krishna, shadow Leela of Krishna, shadow, all abhasas are there. If I remember, let us say I see one pastime of Krishna and then I chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, you are thinking. But that thinking of the Leela of Krishna, Ichaya, is a shadow thinking. It is not transcendental thinking. Therefore, Prabhupada says that avoid the shadow thinking. First, simply you hear. When you hear, then there will be transcendental thinking will come one day. And that's what we want. We do not want shadow thinking. We do not want shadow bhakti. We want real bhakti. Real bhakti comes from real substance. Real substance is internal energy of the Lord. Bhakti energy is there. From bhakti energy, the Leela of the Lord is revealed, then that is what we want. We want real vastu, real substance, eternal substance. And the starting point of real eternal substance is the Shabda, the Nama of the Lord. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Any questions?
Hare Krishna Prabhu. Prabhu, you said that if we read a para and chant, then that thinking will be of a shadow thinking, it's not original. What I was thinking, like generally when we think something, other time, that means we are trying to engage our mind in devotional service. But this was, I was not aware, like it's just a, so is it like a mental concoction, Prabhu, we are doing?
No, when our mind is not pure, whatever we think is tainted with the three modes of material nature. There will be some motivation. There is no purity there. That is the reason why maybe in Satya Yuga you can think of Krishna, there is more purity. Thinking of Krishna is not consciously drilling to think of Krishna is not the Yuga Dharma. The Yuga Dharma is to chant and hear Krishna, and from that thinking will come. The essence finally is to think of Krishna always, right? The goal is to think of Krishna always. But today if I think of Krishna always, I have no purity to think of Krishna always. If I think of Krishna, Krishna has to be there in that. Krishna's thinking and Krishna is non-different. But today when I think of Krishna, I do not know whether it is non-different from Krishna. But today if I chant Hare Krishna, I know it is non-different from Krishna because Krishna has told Kali Kale Nama Rupa Avatara. That is advantage. The Lord has willed that, that means special discount. Discounted path of self-realization is to go through the Nama, touch the Nama with our attention. And then we get qualified, adhikara, purified, the mind gets purified by the touch of the Nama. And then we can, even when you read Leelas of Krishna and Bhagavatam, we will be able to appreciate and taste transcendentally the Leelas of the Lord. So when it comes to, then one may say, the whole day I'm doing service, I'm thinking and thinking of different services. Yes, it is purifying our chaya thinking, because it's not your transcendental mind's thinking, it's not your transcendental intelligence. It's a dovetailing process. You are dovetailing everything in Krishna's service to purify it. Whereas a pure devotee is thinking of preaching, everything is pure devotional service. This is not, it's not about dovetailing. Whatever he does, it's originating from his spirit. Is that?
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Yeah. My question is related to the process of evolutions. So in the previous purport, Srila Prabhupada writes, the development of the consciousness and the next there is the development of the consciousness and next manifestation is the development of the sense perception. So in the process of the evolutions, what comes first? It is the consciousness or the sense perception?
Consciousness. Consciousness, when here Prabhupada means little awareness. Even little awareness is there, then from awareness, sense perceptions come. You can be aware, purely aware, without any sense perception. Just like Prabhupada gave the example that the stone, sometimes there are living entities in the stone. The stone grows, Prabhupada says. That is in the purport only or the previous purport. That means it is simply having little awareness. No sense perception, the stone. So, then the next level of consciousness is starting with different sense perceptions. That does not mean that, you know, evolved living entities won't occupy stone. They can occupy stone also. Himalayas, rivers, they're all fully developed conscious entities whose body is their stone. Next.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Prabhu, my question is that you finished this lecture with this point that chanting and knowing the chanting. Or in the previous lectures, you have mentioned that doing and seeing. So in this chanting process, this with our mouth we are chanting, so that is like doing, and with the ear we are, means two of our senses are engaged. But we in Bhagavatam, we see the experience, we see the example of Ambarish Maharaj. So if we try to analyze his example, how he engaged all his 10 senses simultaneously with full attention, just wanted to know, is it possible? Because if this 10 senses, if we engage them, then there will be competition in this doing and seeing mechanism to divide the attention simultaneously. So how it is possible, how it is, as you are mentioning, it may be possible on the transcendental level, because right now chaya and some, I don't know whether.
No, whatever the senses are, whether it is mind, this sense, or any karmendriya, any jnanendriya. Karmendriya means doing. Jnanendriya means knowing. Correct? So you do something with karmendriya, one karmendriya, and you know about it. For instance, you vibrate with one karmendriya, that is tongue, you vibrate. And you know what you are vibrating. What you are vibrating is resulting in sound. So you track that sound. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Doing and knowing that doing. Right? So knowing and doing are two basic fundamental characteristics of the soul. That is why there is Karmendriya set and there is Jnanendriya set. The soul can do, know, and desire. Do, know, and desire. So, at the soul level, when we are chanting and hearing attentively, you are fully engaging your doing and knowing. Nothing is left there. Your soul is completely absorbed in all your soul, and your entire soul is absorbed in it. If you desire to please Krishna, and with doing and knowing His nama, then you are fully absorbed in it. There is nothing spared left. Now, you want to see the deity? That is another sense, which is, again, sense of sight, right? Which is knowing. So you can engage that also in service of the Lord. Attention you can give. Prabhupada says, if you can meditate on the lotus feet of the Lord during japa, fine. Because somewhere our seeing also has to be, our seeing, otherwise it will see different things. But basically, if we are absorbed in chanting and hearing, seeing is not required.
So Prabhu, just wanted to ask this, like the you mentioned Karmendriya, Jnanendriya. So if this five, they are divided in doing and seeing, and it will not be their division of attention in the doing itself by these five, karmendriya in case of doing and seeing in case of jnanendriya.
Why? That is why you are told not to do anything else. Do only one thing, chanting. Know only one thing, the sound. You have got freedom. You can drive and chant. You can do anything, so many multiple things and chant, but that will divert the attention. Divide the attention in doing. Thinking itself is another doing. Thought processing is another doing, isn't it? Thinking is nothing but a chat between your buddhi and your manas. You give different proposals and the manas is giving proposals and the buddhi is saying yes, no, again. Back and forth they are talking. A chit-chat between the mind and the intelligence is thinking. So that means it is a doing. So if you are engaged in doing of thinking, you cannot do chanting consciously. It goes away.
So then how do we understand the case of Ambarish Maharaj Prabhu? Like 10 senses, how it can be simultaneously engaged?
He didn't simultaneously do it. Where it is said, at one point he did it.
Not possible.
He engaged all his senses throughout the day in different devotional service, not simultaneously. Grandharachimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.